Well, thanks, Suzanne, and welcome to you all. As Suzanne said, I am not Tracy Kidder, although I wish I were. And so I'm really a sub here. But I spoke to Tracy yesterday, and he sends everybody his regards, and wishes you were here, and says, of course, warm hello to you, Jim.
Thanks.
As always. So, Jim, it's a real privilege to get to talk with you, and I've got a few questions I want to ask, and hope the audience will pitch in as well. Sure. Maybe, is that better?
Yeah.
Jim, I thought we'd start with the basics, those who aren't lucky enough yet to have read the book or may not have followed your amazing career. I hope we could just level set here so you can talk a little bit about the program itself. So could you, maybe you could start. What is Boston Healthcare for the Homeless, and how did you get started?
Sure. First of all, thank you, Don, for being here. And I also apologize for not being Tracy Kidder. and I thought I was off the hook until I got the call to be here. So I'm so sorry. But on the other hand, I get to see Don, who has been a hero and a mentor of mine for all my career. Is that okay? More? Oh, it's a speaker? Can you hear me okay if I do this? I guess I better. Can I raise it up to my mouth? Does it come out?
Yeah.
How about that? I'll do that. Thank you. So sorry. I was just saying, what a treat for me to be here with Dr. Berwick, who's been a longtime hero of not only myself, but most of us in medicine, but a real mentor for us, particularly the Boston Healthcare for the Homeless program. But just to give you a quick background, so I started after I finished my residency in medicine, I took what I thought was going to be a one-year job at the request of my chief of medicine. And for those of you who might be in medicine, you know, when you get these requests, they call you into the office, and he wanted me to do something for a year, and they're like rhetorical questions, you know, you can't say no if you value your thing. So much to my chagrin, I took this job. I knew nothing about homelessness. But the city of Boston had been given a grant, a four-year grant by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation in 1985 to try to figure out how to reach out and take care of homeless people, because we were seeing many, many homeless people sort of in the early 80s, mid-80s, coming into the emergency room. So the thought would be, can we go out and try to take care of them so they don't have to come in? So to make a very long story short, the mayor had to sit with a bunch of homeless people and come up with a plan for how they wanted to be served. And so everything I can tell you about our program comes from them, not from me. I wish it had been my idea. And we, to this day, still have homeless people on our board of directors. But they wanted continuity of care. They wanted to have the same doctor wherever they went. They were sick of fragmentation. So our program had to be based on continuity of care. We had to stay part of the hospitals, because when they got sick, that's when they felt most disenfranchised and most stigmatized and most scared. So they wanted their doctors and nurses to be there when they were sick. But then they also said, you can't sit in your offices. You have to come to wherever we are to take care of us. So we had to set up clinics in all of the shelters and soup kitchens, at least as many as we could. By now, we've essentially all of the shelters. And it was the idea of being reach out to see people wherever they are and comfortable. And then if they need more care, bring them into the hospitals and take care of them. And the only other thing I would add, which Don has been so instrumental in helping us through, is they were also really annoyed with doctors like me for kicking them out of the hospital when they're way too sick to go out to the streets or the shelters. So they made us come up with this thing. I remember Governor Dukakis helped us do this, what they called a medical respite program. And it was just someplace where you could go after you had been sick and you were still way too ill to be wandering the streets. So we set up this program where we had 24-hour nurses and doctors where you could come in, essentially a step-down hospital. And that has grown over the years and responded in many ways to the changing healthcare system. So we have about 124 beds now of step-down care in the hospital. So that's kind of our program. It's full of really amazing doctors and nurses working in teams who reach out to wherever they can. And as you, we can talk about, you know, the problems that homeless people run into are huge. There's a huge co-occurring burden of medical, with psychiatric, with substance use disorders. And trying to take care of that population, I've often thought, and I talk to Don about this frequently, if you try to take care of a homeless population, they teach you the weaknesses in our healthcare system really before you know it anywhere else. But let me stop it there, Don. That's it.
Great. So you really got out of the institutional framework of healthcare. People don't come to you, you go to them. in Tracy's book, he describes you making rounds day and night on the streets, finding people where they live and are. Is that right?
That is. As you say it, like, it makes me realize that thank God I was coming out of residency where you're already working about 110 hours a week. So when we cut down to about 90 hours a week, it felt like a vacation, you know? Yes.
How many are there in Boston, in the country? How big a problem is this, or how can we think about numbers, or is that the wrong way to ask the question?
No, I think it's the correct way to ask the question. I'm just thinking if Tracy had been here, this is when he flies off his seat. So the numbers are really hard to get. The numbers we do have been done systematically primarily by HUD, the U.S. Agency for Housing and Urban Development, over the years, where they take one night and all across the country at major cities, they go out and they count everyone they can on that one night. So we've had over the years a sort of a number of how many people, an estimate of how many are out there on one night. But that doesn't tell you if the people who are out tonight may not be the same people who are out a month from now or 2 months from now. So we don't really have an estimate of the total numbers. The most recent HUD estimates are roughly 600,000 people are homeless on a given night. Most of them are adults, but about a third are in family units. But then over the course of a year, it's probably four or five times that. But we don't know. So one of the big controversies is what is the number. Boston, by the way, has about 6,000 to 7,000 homeless people on any given night.
Is this an American problem, or as far as you know, are other countries having to deal with homelessness as well?
I think it's certainly a worldwide problem, but there are countries where the problem is very, very small and isolated. And I would look to many of the Scandinavian countries, for example, have very small problems with this. And they have a lot of social services and a lot of public housing, so they don't see quite the kind of numbers we have. So the uniquely urban American homeless problem, though, is American, I think.
It's ours. We own it. All right, I want to go to the sociology and causes and stuff, but let's stick with your program for another few minutes. I want to get the language straight first. There's some political correctness around here. Do we say homeless, houseless, people experiencing homelessness? How do I stay out of trouble on the language here?
You know, I've given up. I don't think you can stay out of trouble, so you're already in big trouble. But you know, we were given our name, the Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program, in 1985, and that was when healthcare was two words. And when you could say the homeless population, but now, you know, that's probably not. So our name is already in great violation. We've tried to change it several times, but we've been unsuccessful. But here, let me tell you a story the homeless people who are on a board of directors, and we were a very small program. We're not that big now, but it, you know, we're in the $80 million a year. We've got about 600 employees. And there are several homeless people who are on the board and can tell us what to do. And we started to try to be correct and say, you know, people experiencing homelessness, which is kind of that's the right way to say things now. But several of the homeless people on our board hate that because they think it's making it academic. They make it say, that sounds like it's an experience, you know, like that. So they want us to say, they say, we are homeless people, just call us homeless people. So there is no right word. The other thing they said, think of this, we used to say medical, mental health, and substance use, and then it's now changed to behavioral health. And several of the members on our board of directors went crazy because they said, when you say behavioral health, you're impugning my behavior. And they don't like that. And they would much rather have mental health. So you can't, you know, going back and forth, so it's very, very difficult to come up with the right way to say things.
Okay, thanks. So I want to go down one rabbit hole that you triggered here, because you do have homeless people on your board of directors. They've always had a special role, kind of a real design role, it seems to me, in this work, which is a breakthrough in healthcare. That's not the way most healthcare organizations run. They should, but they don't. In the book, there's a wonderful scene with a man named Mike who's on your board, and you're discussing a patient who's basically refusing treatment. And Mike says, our folks have the right to make their own decision, even in the face of death. Can you comment on that?
Yes, I can. I think one of the things I had to learn, and I think all of us had to, is we're so used to taking care of people and, you know, looking for healing stuff, but we're also used to telling people what the best thing to do is. Here's what you should do. And we got slammed by that, because if you've been out on the streets trying to survive for years and some young person comes up and says, here's what you ought to do, the first thing they want to do is just push you away. So we had to learn, as Mike did, that people have the right to make their own decisions. And we're not used to that in the hospital or in medicine. We think, you know, we'll educate you as to what the right decision is. So learning to let go of that and support somebody in whatever their decision is was very hard for our nurses and our doctors at first. But after a while, as we get to know people, you understand where they're coming from, and it's a lot easier. But Mike, who was on our board, was always articulate about that.
You get the sense there's a redistribution of power going on here in a pretty interesting way.
I wish I could claim this, but I hated it at first, because I came from a hospital where the patients had no say in how we did things. But, you know, I don't know if this is in the book or not, Don, but I remember when I first started going out, we took care of people in the shelters and in the hospitals, but during that first year, most of the people who were dying were the ones who were refusing to come into shelter, which is, in Boston, unlike many other cities, only a very small percentage, but they're really a tough group to take care of. And they're feisty, wonderful, but vulnerable. And I'll never forget, I'm on the van. Pine Street Inn has a van that's funded by the Department of Public Health that's been going out every night, think of this, since 1986, from 9 at night till 5 in the morning. It's run by these wonderful people. They most have experienced homelessness themselves or in recovery. And I think if I was going to set up a healthcare system for homeless people, I would start with them. But they know everybody out there, and I would ride with them. They bring soup and sandwiches and blankets, and I got to ride a couple of nights a week to say, as I'm giving soup and sandwiches, if you need anything, I happen to be a doctor. And one night, we're under the bridge. It's late at night, and we got our flashlights. We're trying to see who's sleeping under the Storo bridges near the Charles River. And one guy jumps up at me, and he screams. He said, how would you like your doctor showing up in your bedroom at 2 in the morning unannounced? He had a point. I had to go, oh my God, you know, we were really violating this person's privacy. So we had called our homeless board together and said, what do we do? Is this bad? And so they talked it over and let us know how they wanted to be served. And the only funny part of that, they said, oh yeah, no, please wake us up, please check on us. But he said, take those damn flashlights and flash them on your face, not on everybody else.
Yeah, you shine on your own face first. Isn't that interesting? Okay, before we get into the social system here, let's go back to your own development. So in the book, a fascinating character is Barbara McGinnis. She died in 2003, but she apparently had a tremendous effect on you. And I'd like you to start with the first story that Tracy tells, which is about washing feet.
Yeah, I know Barbara McGinnis was really my real mentor through them. So if any of you are nurses out there, everything I'm telling you, it comes from a nursing perspective. Barbara, when I first got to the shelter, you remember, picture this, I'm coming from Mass General, where I finished my residency. I just finished being the senior medical resident in charge of the intensive care unit. So I'm going 6 blocks down the street to a shelter clinic, and I think, you know, I'm like God's gift to the shelter. Here I am. And I walked in, and there had been this fabulous group of nurses taking care of people at Pine Street Inn for about 15 years. I didn't know anything about them. Barbara McGinnis was the most articulate and one of the longest term. And she brought me in, and they sat me in front of the nurses, read me the riot act about how terrible doctors have been at caring for homeless people, all of which was correct. They told me that I had been trained all wrong, that nothing happens in the life of a homeless person until you take time, until you get to know them, let them trust you, and then you might be able to get them to take blood pressure medicine or something like that. Is that out again? I'm sorry. And so what the nurses did was this brilliant thing where they invited people into the clinic, and this is the men's side of the clinic, and there's 800 people at the shelter. And they would come in and they would soak the men's feet. They invite them in by name, soak their feet, be really respectful to them. And Barbara said, now look, give me your medical stuff. She took my stethoscope and all my stuff. And for 2 months, I had to soak feet. So I went from the ICU, where we're in charge of everything, to soaking people's feet. And I wasn't allowed to ask, you know, hearing voices, all this stuff. I couldn't get their chief complaint. And it was an amazing experience. It was flipping the power structure. I was at the foot of someone. I wasn't in their personal space. We're using the stethoscopes length away from that. And the nurses were just brilliant. You know, I got to know people over time, shared coffee with them, talked to them, all the things that I think once we had said was past a professional boundary. And they said, here, you just have to be part of it. And that's what I did. And it was, I could tell you stories about how that changed things, but it was great.
How did it change you?
Well, it took all, you know, if I had any airs of sophistication, it took it all away. And what I realize is an awful lot of, you know, humility is part of serving people. And I had to learn, you know, I didn't have the tools to help someone. I needed to learn what those tools were. I knew how to write a prescription, but I had no idea how to follow through. We also, at the time, it was the beginning of the AIDS epidemic, and it was also, we had a terrible outbreak of pulmonary tuberculosis, so it was a really poignant time to try.
You were doing some pretty serious stuff, AIDS, the AIDS epidemic, and TB at the same time in this population.
That's right.
What was that like?
Well, I rapidly learned that what I thought had been so difficult in the ICU seemed simple compared to taking care of people with these very complicated problems in a setting like a shelter where they were wandering around all day and had no support. So what we learned there, to be very honest with you, to make another long story short, is that I learned that I was useless as a doctor unless I was part of a team, unless I worked with the nurses, the public health department, the city, the shelters, and the hospitals, and the specialty clinics. So we learned that we were all in this together, and any thoughts of I was doing this on my own went rapidly out.
The team theme comes through everywhere. Right. And I'm going to switch gears now, but we will get to politics, but only at the end. When I talked to Tracy, I said, what would you pursue? He said, one of the most remarkable things Tracy saw, and I see it in the book, I know it in Jim, is seeing every person as an individual. And in the book, it's full of vignettes, and the names just pour out in this book. When I'm on the streets of Boston walking past a homeless person, I avert my eyes. I try to figure out whether to give money, and usually don't. I certainly don't know them. Tracy, I don't know if it's your term or Tracy's, but he uses the term pre-admiration. Pre-admiration, the concept that before you even know the person, you see the potential to admire them. It reminded me of a quote, one of my favorite quotes, so this is your interview, not mine, but let me just mention it. Father Greg Boyle from Homeboy, if you haven't Googled him, unbelievable. One of his many, many aphorisms is, he says, here is what we seek, a compassion that can stand in awe at what the poor have to carry rather than stand in judgment as to how they carry it. That thought infuses this your story, Jim. It comes out in the names of people, and there's many, many names in the book, as I said, and we don't have time to do a deep dive, but I want to do a deep dive on two names that appear. Two, I gather, former college professors, Harrison and David. Can you talk about them a little bit and explain how you ended up having lunch with them at Union Oyster House every month? Huh?
Sure. By the way, I am an ardent admirer and a little bit of a friend of Father Boyle, who is quite amazing. If you don't know Father Boyle, you need to learn about him. Oh, it's not coming through again? I'm so sorry. I have to put it right up here. One of the things that I've learned is it's you do need to take time to learn people's stories. And that term pre-admiration was somebody else. I never thought through that. But we've learned that we were almost always completely wrong when your first impression of someone. And as you heard this story and got to know them, you started to understand that, wow, this is somebody who's acting with incredible courage against really, well, I guess maybe I have to put it right in my mouth. Sorry about that. Against really, you know, when they've been dealt a terrible hand. But every once in a while, these extraordinary things happen. So one man I used to see, and this is a man who was in his 70s, was wandering the streets, very furtive, wouldn't let me talk to him. I'd try hard to get him. And finally, after about 5 years, he started to talk to me, and he told me he was the youngest professor ever at Columbia University. And you know, we hear these things all the time. And I said, "Oh yeah, what did you teach?" And he said, "I was a philosophy professor, and I taught some English to the undergrads." And so he used to come into the clinic. I lured him into the clinic, and we'd have lunch together in the clinic, and we'd talk about books or stuff he had done. And he was fascinating. He wouldn't let me take his blood pressure; couldn't do any of that stuff. But he would let me talk to him about things. So I always did my lunch hour with him. I asked him about when he was at Columbia, and it turned out it was during the time of the Beat Generation, which I was fascinated by. And it was a time when I had done philosophy as an undergrad. And I said, "How about Van Dorn? Did you know Van Dorn?" And he'd tell me not so much about his philosophy, but all about his wife and his mistresses and everything else. And I got fascinated, but I had no idea what this guy was, whether it was true or not. And then they finally said, "How about Jack Kerouac? Did you ever meet Jack Kerouac, who was a hero of mine, right?" And he goes, "Oh my gosh." He said, "Yes, Jack was a dashing young man." But then he goes, "But a terribly shallow thinker." Put me right in my spot. But anyway, to make a long story short, one day he got very sick and he came in. One of the joys of as you get to know people, you know when they do need you, then they can trust you. So he came in, he had his heart was going into bad failure. We brought him upstairs and we were admitting him to the hospital, and the residents were asking me, "Do you know anything about him?" And I said, "Yeah." He told me, "He's the youngest professor ever at Columbia, but I don't really know." And they said, "Well, what about his blood pressure?" And I've known the guy now for 10 years. And I said, "I have no idea." And you can imagine what the residents thought of me. But they Googled him. This was in the days I didn't know how to Google. And it turned out he was, what up came up with some letters. One of the letters was from Allen Ginsberg to this patient of ours. And it said, "Dear Rich, thank you so much for spending last weekend on Long Island with me and our friends Neil and Jack." And he said, but then the kicker was, and he said, "And I want to thank you particularly for helping me try to convince him that this trip they're planning to San Francisco is insane." And of course, that's when he wrote On the Road. So anyway, he was a shining star of the Beat Generation. He was teaching at Columbia when he was 16. He had his first schizophrenic break when he was 19. So he had this ascendant career and then spent the next 50 years on the streets of America, lost to the Beat Generation. So, and he's the one that he and another friend who was a Yale professor were in a nursing home. And the only way I could keep in the nursing home was to take them to the Union Oyster House for clam chowder every month when the checks came. So that was my joy in life. So
I do get the feeling, maybe I'm overstating it, but if we had the time here to talk about each of dozens and dozens of these people that were part of your life, you would also be able to talk about them as individuals, their stories, their backgrounds, and each comes through as an individual. Tracy said last night, I think Jim gives concierge care, which the rest of us can't get. That's how it feels. Okay, so even though individuation is so deeply part of of the story here, at least to me, Jim, is there a standard pathway to homelessness? Is there a common causal system here? Something that you find over and over again in the stories you hear from these people?
Yes, I think when I now think about homelessness, I used to think I understood it back in 1985, and now I think it is a very complicated, complex problem. And all sorts of people end up homeless for all sorts of different reasons. When we look at just the people living on the streets, who are this subpopulation of the homeless, at least in Boston, the thing that I always keep in mind is that, one, when we've looked at their mortality rates, they're about 12 times that of somebody the same age living in Boston. So this is in a world with rich medical services. They're dying at rates that look like a third world country. Second thing that always I have to cope with is about 25% of the men on the streets, and it's mostly men, it's about 4 men to every woman, cannot read or write. So what does that say? It says that this is not a sudden problem. This is something that happened back when they were children, in the adverse circumstances they lived under, and this is where Don is an expert, adverse childhood events. But most of them grew up with, issues that were not recognized by the situation, so they didn't have their ADD treated or acknowledged. So they become troublemakers who don't get through school. And then they never learn to read or write, and they can't get jobs. So for many of them, they're not people who you think of rehabilitation. These are people who've really never had a chance. So when I think of that segment, and that's only a small, I don't remember most homeless people with a house or a home, they'll be fine. But for the ones who really end up chronically on the streets, chronically in the shelters, is usually very complicated things that have gone on. And what we really need to address is what happened 40 years ago. And then we're trying to cope with that. Is that fair enough, Don?
We'll go more deeply now. I mean, question, sort of the subordinate question is why in the wealthiest nation on earth does anyone not have a home? And understanding more deeply that causal system, I'd like to spend the next few minutes on it. Then I'm done. Then it's up to you. So I hope you'll get some questions ready. But I want to go further into societal views. Although there's in the book, there's a conversation with Barbara McGinnis, in which I guess you or somebody raises this, and she says, "Don't bother me. I'm too busy doing the work." Is that true?
It's absolutely true. When I first started, you can all imagine, I was incensed by I was outraged by the fact we had so many people that didn't have homes. And I was trying to take care of people with TB and AIDS and do all that. And at the same time, I'm thinking, we could prevent all this if we just do something. I remember going to Barbara and saying, "Barbara, what do we do about this?" And she'd look at me and she'd go, as she did with anybody, she said, "You know, I'm too busy. We've got too much to do right now. Leave me alone." And there is a wisdom in that that I've realized now. There's like two issues going on.
Yeah, get the job done. She asks you, "Who do you think you are, God? Let's get the feet washed." Yeah,
put me in my place.
Okay, but let's go to the societal view. So I regard this as a travesty. Is it almost a test case of a country that can work as with solidarity and compassion and a sense of mutual responsibility? There is another view in the book. Tracy quotes an interview between David Brinkley and Ronald Reagan at the end of Reagan's presidency, and I can't read the whole thing, but Reagan, who cut supports to homelessness and housing, said some were mentally impaired, consigned to wander the streets because left-wing lawyers had shut down mental hospitals. Some were too poor to buy or rent homes because they didn't want to work. And ignored hundreds of ads offering jobs. Others simply chose to live outside even though there were shelters all over the country. They make it their own choice for staying out there, said the president. There is a meme which says, if you're in trouble, you made your trouble. And we're a country of individual responsibility. Can you talk about that?
If I'm really honest, I can think of maybe two people I've run into in almost 40 years who I would say really chose to be out on the streets or chose to be homelessness. And as you get to know everyone else, there's been a long, painful, arduous journey that's never a straight line. It's always a crooked line. But I don't know anyone out there who really wants to be there or has chosen to be there. And now I know that's a very street-level thing, and I'm sure at another level you might say differently. But I see this as a structural societal problem, not an individual problem. And I know that can be very controversial, but I mean, it's individual. If you're born with a terrible mental illness, then you need some support to stay in housing. If you don't have that support, you're going to be homeless. So they don't choose homelessness. We just don't have a way to take care of them. But I could go on, and then I think it's a real, a real failure of us, a moral and a practical failure of us as a society to have so many homeless people.
It's sort of a trigger issue for me, you know, when I got to run Medicare and Medicaid, and this conversation about Medicaid work requirements, if these people really should be working, it's like they never met Medicaid patients. I remember meeting with a CEO of a hospital who had a list of 10 Medicaid patients. Every single one of them was struggling as hard as they could to get through life. And this idea, why don't you just get a job? It was so blind. Okay, so let's fix it. I know you tend to step away from the policy world too quickly, in my view. But I'd love to know make some changes in America, in this country, in terms of our policies as they affect this group of people. What would you do? What would be your priority list of things we should be changing in public policy?
So this, Don and I have talked about this a little bit, so I'll share with you my... So I actually, when I step back it, I think of homelessness as kind of the end result of a lot of things going on. So when I say, how are we going to fix it? We're going to fix it by addressing the weaknesses in many sectors of our society. And I, Tracy and I often spar back and forth, but I think if you would just fix our education system, you would get rid of 90% of homeless people in 20 years. So I... Among other things, I think we should be paying teachers $200,000 or $300,000 a year to take care of our kids. And what we're seeing are people so far down the line that we're really just struggling to take care of them. In many ways, it's more palliative than it is preventive. But the other thing, so I think, you know, we need to fix corrections, we need to fix welfare, all the things you can imagine. Now, that said, practically speaking, you know, we can't fix this without enough housing, and housing has to be scaled to a level to make sure everyone has an opportunity for it. And that is a challenge. You know, I was just reading, I'm sure you saw that, I was just reading in New York City where they've now got 100,000 homeless people. The only one closer is Los Angeles, which has about 70,000 homeless people, and these are just two urban centers. And when they looked at New York City public housing this a couple weeks ago, they realized just to get it back up to code, the public housing that exists, is going to cost $80 billion. So you start to say, what's the level at which we have to invest in housing? It's going to be significant, and anything short of that is going to always leave us with a problem. So I think we have to, as a society, at first, figure out policies that allow us to build housing for people wherever it needs to be in the right way. And, you know, I could go on about that, but I think housing is the scene. And as Don knows, and I also have a thing for some of the people who are homeless who have been out there a long time and struggle, once they get into housing, it's imperative that we come up with the supports to help them stay in that housing. And I don't see that being funded anywhere in the in our big cities. And I worry a lot about that's when I remember when Don was at CMS, one of the things that is so key for us is you can do an awful lot of creative things with Medicaid and Medicare. If we just recognize that the support in housing is what needs to be done, and that's where I turn to you.
It's kind of like teamwork at the policy level, where we really have to work together. All right, so now the time is yours. How much time do we have left here, Suzanne? About 9 minutes left. So a couple questions, short ones, please. Hand up over there. No. Yes, Roseanne. Okay, Rosemary.
Yeah, two quick things on the housing. One is, in your book, there's discussion about the issue of peer groups and housing, that once you're successful in getting an individual place in housing, there's obviously a person who wants to have friends over, and the friends become disruptive, and the housing issue becomes more complicated. So it tends to lead me to think that it's not an individual issue, it's really a social group issue. And there have been some efforts to start community-level housing, and I'm just wondering what your comments are about that.
I think your point is really well taken, and I would say that I think we know what to do, we know how to handle that, and Don and I are very familiar with Community Solutions led by Roseanne Haggerty, and they have shown around the country that there are ways you can do that kind of housing. It's expensive, and it needs to be done, you know, you need policy to support. So I think we know how to do that. The cost of it, though, like the housing, has become so far prohibitive. So I think that's what we have to work on. We have to learn how, through creative things like Medicaid funding, those kinds of things, or getting new policies for that. But I turn to Don. You've done a lot on this. What do you think?
I think we should follow your instructions and Roseanne Haggerty's. In terms of the cost, we don't want to talk much about cost. In the book, no one asks the question, does doing an appendectomy save money? That's the wrong question. In this case, I think it may be the same morality, but I actually think if we elevated our eyes, extended the time horizon, it's really stupid financially what we're doing. We are paying so much for the failure to invest upstream. Thanks.
And then I would just invite you to talk a little bit about Tony, because he's such a key character in the book. Okay.
It's hard to talk about Tony quickly. But You know, I think what I would share with you, and you should read the book, because Tracy had a very special relationship with Tony, and he's like one of the many people that I, you know, feel, you know, privileged to be part of his life. But Tony was, you know, was an example of someone who had, you know, made a mistake, spent a long time in jail, came out, and then could not get back into society because of the rules we have. So here he spends 20 years in prison, comes out after pain, and then he can't get housing. So he's kind of condemned to being on the street. And he was a man with immense, you know, heart, immense, really talented, but had never been to school, and really was like, just wanted to help. He just wanted to be part of us. We wouldn't let him, and he couldn't get into housing and that. And that story is really hard to take because, you know, we could have invested a little bit in this man and he would have had a great life.
And he helped a lot with the program during times when he had his act together.
He did. Yeah. He was amazing. I think Tracy says it, but you know, he was a huge guy. We were a little frightened of him at first, but he had a gentle soul. And what we learned as we were out on the streets, he took care of everybody. He made sure no one picked on homeless people, especially homeless women. And so he became what we call the night watchman.
So I wish think we time could have for paid him. One more question, perhaps.
Yeah, if you mentioned earlier when you walk up and down the street, sometimes you run across a homeless person, you avert your eyes, you give money, sometimes you don't give money. Dr. Connelly O'Connell, how did you approach this, and what did Barbara McGinnis tell you about how you might think of the homeless in that situation?
And let me add, what should we do?
No, and that's a great question. So the question is, what do you do about giving? And I was frantic about this in the beginning because I walked into Pine Street and 40 people had asked me for money and what can I do? And Barbara and the nurses had a very interesting thing. They just said, look, people aren't necessarily they'd love money, but they're not looking necessarily for money. They're looking to be recognized, to be seen. So Barbara used to just teach us to look somebody in the eye and say, sorry, I don't have any money today, but acknowledge them. And believe it or not, the homeless people on our board of directors say, really, that's the most important thing. If you have something, it's nice to give to them. You know, we've learned that, for example, Dunkin' Donuts cards, it sounds crazy, but a Dunkin' Donuts card, and I don't mean to pick on, it could be Starbucks, but it gave you access to go into Dunkin' Donuts, buy a cup of coffee, sit down in the warm, and use a bathroom. So a little card was a ticket to, you know, sort of an hour of something they needed. But anyway, that's what I would urge you, you know, always acknowledge somebody. Just say, sorry, I don't have anything, but how you doing?
Thanks. And that helps. We do have time for one more question. Did you have your name your hand up in the back? Yes. Just yell loud.
So first, I appreciate the tip about the Dunkin' Donuts card, because I never know quite what to do. And I have not read your book yet, and perhaps this is also answered in your book, but what organizations give you hope, make you feel that they're making a difference? I think a lot of us want to do something, and because we work, we have family, we can't volunteer our time. But which organizations do you feel give you hope?
That is a great question, and I should prepare to answer that. But first of all, there's a ton of really wonderful stuff going on around the country. So there's really good stuff. I don't know yet. I'd love to learn what's going on here at Martha's Vineyard. But in a place like Boston, I mean, we always, you know, we live and breathe and die by donations that help us take the extra time with people. But there are all sorts of institutions like Pine Street Inn, St. Francis House, in a city like Boston, which money given to them is really well used. And I would say the other things we're learning, you know, food banks, home health care agencies, all of those are really key to what we need. And then one of the things that I talked to Don about, we can't do the care of very sick people when we see them on the street unless we have really good access to specialty care in hospitals and inpatient care. So I would support your local healthcare from a selfish side so that they can open up and make sure they make access good for the people coming in. That's a little tricky, but that's what I would say. Okay, thank you for the question.
Jim, are you optimist or pessimist on this?
Well, you know, I'm going to be a wishy-washy here. I have had what I think is the best job ever. I get to take care of people who really, you know, really appreciate you take care of them. And I get to be a doctor, which has been, you know, I'm grateful for that. When I think about will we as a society really step back and tackle this problem, I get a little pessimistic, certainly in this current environment. But I don't give up yet. I'm pessimistic but not cynical yet.
All right. Well, it's in our hands. Jim, I can't thank you enough
for this. Thank you, Don. I appreciate it. Okay. Thank you very much.